welcome to the Just for Gamers video game podcast. Episode 75, Smooth Transitions. In this episode, we're all about the World Wars. JfG Ash doesn't know the days of the week. JfG Alex says something crazy about the new Pro Evo. We have a special mini moon to go. And finally, we have more audio quizness. So once again, please get in contact with us. You know who we are. You know where to find us.
Hello and welcome to the JfG podcast. This is episode 75. My name is Alex and I'm joined as ever by my good friend Ash. Hey buddy, how you doing?
Yeah buddy, I'm good for a Wednesday.
All right for a Wednesday, eh?
Not bad for a Wednesday, buddy.
Well, that's all you can ask for at this point in the year, buddy.
I mean, I'm in shorts today. I thought, you know, I'm going to get prepared. Feeling, seems that it's been pretty hot recently. But yeah, I'm feeling good. Feeling rigid. Yeah. Ready to talk about some video games, you know.
Nice, buddy. I too am nursing a semi. I've been wearing swimming trunks for the last fortnight since I got back from Sweden. Ooh. It's like I've just been too hot all the time.
Have you showered in them as well? You just kept them on.
Well, that's the beauty of them, buddy. Is you never have to take them off, and you can wash them with yourself. So that's no way. I've been washing them separately from my junk, but at the same time, if I wanted to, heaven forbid anyone should question it. That's what I think.
Well, totally, buddy. I mean, if you wash your head with shampoo, it's going to wash the rest of your body while you're in the shower. Surely.
Yeah, you don't need anything else.
Totally, love it. Yep. Yeah. So, buddy, have you been up to much this week? Because I forgot to write anything down, so I can't remember a thing that I've done.
I can only remember things that I have done if I wrote them and can read them off of a screen.
Yeah, I mean, that's what this whole thing is, isn't it? I just, you know, I write a script beforehand. You know,
things what I have
think
done.
That I'm this stupid, but I actually prepare my stupidity so I'd sound really stupid.
Well, it's the sort of skill level and detail that any modern comic would go to, buddy, and that's the beauty of it.
It's so true.
No, I've been enjoying the bank holiday weekend, although...
That happened. I know something about that. I can comment on that later.
There you go. Pros and cons to the bank holiday weekend.
What are the cons, buddy? Come on, bad news first.
The bad news was that I didn't get the chance to see you.
Yeah, that's true. We tried to arrange a meet, but it just wasn't happening, was it?
No, you were over your neck of the woods, and I was all set to come over and see you, and then I kind of got collared into doing some house clearing, despite the fact that it was like 30 degrees.
Sounds fun. So,
yeah, I was cleaning out, and it was the top room. Like my grandparents are pretty posh, and he's like in a nursing home, and they're like selling off loads of their stuff, and So, yeah, it was in the games room, like the snooker room on the top of the house. But nice. It's just so hot. It's like crazy
that
hot.
That will happen,
there.
Buddy.
But, yeah, so I didn't get the chance to see you. I was kind of tied up all day. On the plus side, though, he did give me this record player, which is amazing. It's like an actual, like a cabinet with a... With a tape deck and a turntable,
cassette, it's like, buddy, I believe.
Actual cassette, yeah.
Cassette,
it's
nice.
It's like full wood panels, and it's got all like the giant silver like dials on the front and everything. It's called it's by everyone's favorite company, Dynatron, buddy.
Ooh.
So so you know it's good.
My favorite make,
in it, yeah.
Oh, definitely.
So it. It needs a belt, which I didn't even know that those were a thing.
Yeah.
But now I do, so I need to buy one of those with my Prime membership that I now have, buddy. So,
ooh,
cock of the walk. Yeah. Got my Prime. Nice. Been watching lots of shit TV shows like Constantine and Lucifer. Bit of a theme there. But yeah, so yeah, that was my Saturday, buddy. On Sunday, I went to a wedding by the seaside.
Ooh, I like the seaside. Weddings, not so much.
Well, it didn't feel like a wedding. It felt like a day out because the actual ceremony to took place in a theatre on a stage. So
that's odd.
There were songs. There was a dance act as well.
So it was like a musical wedding. On stage.
Yeah, well, the groom is a good friend of mine who is in a band that we both know quite well, One Day Elliot. And so there was music from his bandmates and stuff. And his bride, she's the director of a like music troupe that do amateur dramatics for kids with mental illness and stuff like that.
Okay.
So they had like a mixture of songs, and then they had some like amateur dramatics, which was quite fun. And then the second half of the day just was like, let's go down to the beach, get pissed, maybe have some cocktails. And yeah, it was cool. It was really good. It was a good day out.
Sounds nice, buddy. Sounds like a hoot.
Yeah, weather held up. It was a lovely Sunday. And then Monday had a barbecue with the folks, buddy. Just stayed in and enjoyed the time off and the fact that I'd normally be sweating my tits off at work. So that was nice. How about you? What did you get up to?
Ah, well, I guess I can talk about the bank holiday, seeing as you've reminded me that that was a thing.
You are welcome, sir.
Cheers, buddy. Yeah, so I drove down to see my folks on the Friday after work, which is always fun, you know. A good 3 hours in the car with three kids goes down well, buddy. Always a fun time.
Sounds brilliant.
That experience was right. Two of them fell asleep and the other one was just watching his tablet the whole way. So that was cool. Had some lovely food from my dad, being a superstar chef and shit. So that was good, good. On the Saturday, buddy, while you were sweating your balls off moving stuff and getting cassette recorders and whatever, I don't know, crazy stuff, I was busy in an outside swimming pool, an old Victorian swimming pool, buddy, having fun. My bad.
Sounds better than what I was doing. And also, like, almost a direct retort to my sweatiness, the fact that you were having a swim about in the outside.
Yeah. I think so. I mean, I'm laying it on a bit thick there. But yeah, it was a great day. It's got a slide and, you know, a diving board and everything. It was wicked. Like, got my son doing some diving for the first time, which was sweet. And yeah, it was good. On the Saturday, didn't really do much because it kind of rained quite a bit. So watched the Grand Prix, which is, you know, always fun. And I must say it was an interesting one this week.
That was a great race, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, those first 10 laps were just like insane. It was absolutely crazy. I didn't know what was going to happen. And yeah, chilled out with my dad watching loads of sport, which is a rarity for me these days, because normally I'm busy doing patios and shit, whatever, you know. But yeah, it was a good weekend. Obviously, drove back on the Monday, got back, and then immediately was like, right, I've got chores to do. So mowed the lawn, did some mining. Exciting times. But apart from
that, buddy.
Been playing some games. We bought a new game. Been on a beta, you know. I was worried that I wouldn't have many games to talk about this week, but fucking, we got them in. We did well.
It's quite the haul, to be honest. There's lots to get stuck into, buddy. I suppose we should probably just head there now.
I think so.
Let's go and talk about what we've been playing. So yeah, I think we've played almost exactly the same stuff. Got a couple of different ones. I very briefly will talk about my different one. I'm still playing No Man's Sky, buddy. I must be up to the same sort of time that you were at.
Yeah.
When you lost interest. Although I was kind of showing it off to the missus and she really, really liked it. So I think that might be one of the reasons why I was we played like 2 or 3 hours together on Saturday night, I think it was. And she really liked it, so that might be why. But I'm still enjoying that game, and I will keep you posted as to whether that changes or not. But yeah, nothing to report, obviously. I think that game has been talked to death now. There's nothing to say anymore.
I think so. We've definitely said our piece on it.
So, definitely. So, you played a couple of things. Well, I played F1. That was the other one I played because you missed game night because you were on your way down to your folks' place, weren't you?
Unfortunately, which is always a shame.
We had a real good F1 session. We played, all 25% of races, so like sort of 12 to 15 lap races with a bit of safety car and pit stops and stuff. And it was really good fun. And it was cool. Pretty intense, but once you get used to drinking on the straights, then you're fine.
That's what it's all about, buddy.
Still disappointed with the graphics in that thing. Like, really annoying how the screen tearing and stuff is pretty nasty. I'm hoping that they'll patch it. But other than that, cool game, and still playing through my career. Next week, I'm going to do quite a bit of streaming, and F1 will be one of the things that I stream. So if you like that sort of thing, then keep an eye on our YouTube channel for that.
Cool, buddy. I will do.
So what have you played without me, buddy?
I went back to the Hitman beta because, you know, obviously that's a thing that sane people do. Yeah.
Well, it's... for some reason freely available forever, so why wouldn't you?
Yeah, true. It's I'm gagging for that game now. I need to buy it soon, I feel.
Well, fair. They've announced the disc release this week, like it's like January, I think.
That was in my section, but you know, we can do it now. That's fine.
Sorry, buddy.
It's all right. Ruined it for me. That was one of my, probably the highest point of my favorite news things of the week, buddy.
Well, at least that wasn't written down in the document, and I didn't like.
Well, you know, I like to keep you on your toes when it comes to my section. I couldn't
possibly have known it was in your section.
I know. You know now, though.
I do now.
Now you know.
Moving on.
But yeah, I don't know if I can wait until that comes out. Like, do you reckon it won't change? Because like, we'll buy it on the PlayStation Store, obviously. There's no point in waiting for that unless there's with the disc version, you get all like the bonus levels and everything as well. But I would have thought you get that anyway with the season pass. You can go back and replay them. It surely wouldn't be like a timed exclusive. I don't know. I need to investigate.
I don't know how it works. I need to look back into it. I mean, how cheap is it on the store at the moment?
It's the price of a normal game, like 45 quid, I reckon, for the year's content.
Yeah. I mean, I've been looking at the Deus Ex reviews, and they're not pretty, a lot of them. Much sort of 5, 6s and 7s.
But then again, buddy, talking about Deus Ex, I've been playing Deus Ex Mango.
Deus Ex Mango?
Indeed, I played Deus Ex Mango over the weekend. Obviously, I took old tablet, so this could be a bit of tablet watch here.
Tablet watch.
And I took it down with me over the weekend. And yeah, I bought Deus Ex Go. I think it was like $3.99 on the store. I had, thanks to Funk telling me about like that survey thing or whatever it is, where you get like credit for doing surveys. Yeah, I've been doing that. So I had like £2 just stashed away. And I was like, yeah, I'll do that. Just spend that and then, you know, $1.99 from me. And, it's all right, isn't it? It's like the other ones. It's the same type of game, but with Deus Ex Mango on it.
So it's like exactly the same game. So it's almost like buying a theme Monopoly or something like that, where it's the same rules each time. Exactly.
The rules are kind of different because obviously different enemies do different things. I think I'm like about 30 levels into this now. That I would say that's the main difference so far is the enemies. In Lara Croft Go, you've got like verticality to it as well. I don't think you've got that in Hitman. You have different levels, but like you use like secret passages to get from one level to the other. Whereas in Lara Croft, you like scale up the side of the wall. In this one, I haven't come across any verticality yet, but like I said, I'm only about 30 levels in. There's like cool aspects of like computer hacking kind of things. So you go over a certain icon and you can hack like a turret or like, I don't know, a red hexagon on the floor, which seems like nothing can go through it until you open it. I don't know what that symbolizes, but yeah. I was playing this with my son as well. It's got some like nice little cutscenes in there, obviously just like animated stuff. But the language is atrocious. I was like, wow, this needs to be highlighted on some sort of...
Super sweary?
Yeah, there's like, fuck this, I'm going to rape you. Obviously, it probably doesn't say that, but you know, you get the gist.
Has it got a certificate?
I don't know. I don't know if these things do. And I was just like, imagine if like, you know, like... My son, 6, he bought, well, I got him, like, Lara Croft Go and, like, Hitman Go. I guess Hitman Go, maybe not for a 6-year-old, because even though it's just, like, characters, I guess it is killing people. I don't know. But in this, yeah, it's a little bit racy, buddy.
Well, it's a bit intense. Yeah, worth noting that. You could easily come unstuck there, wouldn't you, if you weren't techno dad like
exactly,
you are.
Techno dad. Scooter. Yeah, techno dad.
Techno dad, yeah. On the case, keeping away.
Gibbons. I really like the mango selection that's on the store right now. It's pretty cool. I don't recommend buying these for like consoles or anything.
That's what I was about to ask, because I know they're on the PlayStation store.
They're definitely a tablet / phone game, and also they're a lot cheaper on that, or on Android or I think it's on iOS. I don't know. Probably is.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. So yeah, I like them. If you can get one for cheap, I know that the Hitman and Lara Croft ones went on for like 10p, like I don't know, 6 months ago. So it might happen again. Who knows? I recommend picking them up when they're in a sale. Or you could just buy them full price. It's up to you. Still a good game.
Cool. Mm. Nice, buddy. Well, in that case, let's talk about the things that we have played together. And let us start with Video Ball.
Gibbons, buddy. So once again, we did a gaming live stream on YouTube on Monday night at around about 8 p.m. bisexual
time. That's our weekly slot.
Indeed. BST, if that's what we are, who knows. And yeah, we played this week, we played a selection of Video Ball Trials Fusion again, which was odd.
Great game.
Yeah, it's really bringing me back into it, which is cool. Trials Fusion, and finishing off with a classic, Tricky Towers, which is just
game of the year 2016.
I think so, you know.
Like, indeed.
But then again, we might have a new contender for that right now. Who knows?
Yes.
But we'll get into that anyway. Video Ball, did we actually talk about this when we first bought it? Or
I can't remember if we spoke about it.
We should probably just
week.
Be like, yeah, this game's awesome. Loads of fun. We need some other people to get it and play it as like 4-player, like a 2-on-2 kind of thing. That'd be
loads
of fun.
Yeah, because one of the best things about it is you can have multiple balls. And
Multiple.
And yeah, you can play 2-on-2. It's got full online. There's so many things to love here. The presentation's amazing, and the music's fantastic as well.
The commentary's pretty special.
Yeah, this double touchy. This game is so addictive, and at first when you start playing, basically this is a top-down game. It's cross asteroids with Pong, and you have this. And that's all you need to know about it. The longer you hold down your shoot button, the harder you can throw it, and if you hold it down for like 5 seconds, it creates a barrier that you can put down to try and block your goal off, and so on.
Defensive mechanisms. Like,
but there's so much to it. Like, it feels so simple at first, and then more and more things kind of reveal themselves. The way you can kind of use rebounds, and if the ball hits you, then it stops dead, so you can kind of sacrifice yourself and that sort of thing. There's so much going on here. I was playing it with you. I was playing it with the missus over the weekend. She loved it as well, and it's just highly addictive, and I think it's £3.50 on the store at the moment. It'd be about $5 in the States, I'd imagine. this is an absolute bargain. If you have anyone to play this with, then buy it. It's the price of a pint of beer, and just for the music alone, it's worth getting, I think.
Yeah, if you need convincing, just, you know, our live stream is on our YouTube channel. Go and check it out, you know, even if it's just for a minute to see if you want to play this game. I want to play this game right now, buddy. So
yeah, man, I suspect it's what we'll load up when we finish doing this. But yeah, head to over. All our streams are archived, so you can just catch and see a little bit of it
now
going.
Some beautiful thumbnails as well.
Gorgeous lightning-esque thumbnails from you, buddy. Very nice indeed.
Indeed, buddy. Right, so that's that. What about
fucking game?
The PES demo.
Yeah,
you know,
we've been playing the PES
out.
Demo. We both forgot that it was out, so we didn't make use of our US accounts to get it a day early.
Standard.
how much of this have you played? I think I've played about 10 matches.
I've played about two or three games, and then I was okay, let's come back to this.
So the more I play it, the more I can see the differences. When I first played it, I was like, what the fuck is this? Because I couldn't even tell the difference. I loaded it up, and then I played a game of the old one, and then I loaded it up again, and then I played a game of the old one, and I was just like, there's nothing here. Like, but the more I play it, the more I see the nuances, the differences. The goalkeepers are a massive improvement.
Goalkeepers are hugely different, like the way they attempt to save the ball and everything. Like, the animations look more like realistic, and
the animation's nicer, the pressing's nicer, and the graphics are slightly nicer, but we're talking like 5% or something.
Like, not amazing, much better. I would say the character movement was the first thing that I noticed that was different to the previous games. I don't know if it was faster or
that's
more
the thing.
Fluid or
I think
something.
It's smoother.
It was different, though. Yeah. I think
and
so.
I think it looks quicker, but the actual gameplay is slower, which is confusing. All of the movement and the animation and everything looks faster than the old game, but the actual act of moving the ball up the pitch and trying to score a goal is slower. You have to knock it around more because the defense is better. They stay in their positions better, and it's one of those like. This is an upgrade. This is a light upgrade rather than a new game. And I'm seriously questioning whether it's good value for us to buy this from the off. But I've never really said that before. I always want to get a new football game when it comes out.
This is crazy talk, buddy. But you know what? My theory is like every time we come round to this, I'm like, hey, let's just wait till like Christmas time. So December. It'll go in the sale for like £25. Always
it
does.
It will, but the always issues does. Are always the server side stuff. So Konami have always had a bit of a habit of shifting all of the old game servers onto the new one, and the old game becomes almost unplayable online. And if that happens, then I'm going to want the new one straight away. But I'm starting to think it might be worth waiting and seeing if that happens, seeing if the old game is still playable.
Because there's no reason to just not to try it out and wait.
We need to talk to the others and see how they're feeling about it. I know that Funk's been playing the demo and so's PJ.
Yeah.
But at this point for me, and I might have changed my tune by this point next week when I've played that demo more. But
probably.
At this point for me, I just don't think there's enough there for me to shell out again other than, you know, player transfers, which obviously it's a big deal if you're playing single player, but obviously you don't do that, so you probably don't give a shit about that, do you?
Not one bit.
No.
Not at all.
Well, it's an interesting one, and I'm sure now that we've spoken about it, PJ and Funk will have some stuff to say. Sorry, PJ and Funken.
That's true. Good
shit. We'll have some things to say about it next time round. But we'll move on for now, I think, buddy.
Gibbons, bunny. So, bunny? Buddy. That's weird. Gibbons, buddy. So from one demo, I guess, to another one that's not called a demo. It's called an open beta, which is, you know, another word for demo. And that's the Battlefield 1 open beta, buddy. We got access to it a day early or 2 days early or something like that. Through our sneaky signing up to the EA insider bollocks that we told everyone about, I think.
Yeah, good shout with that, buddy.
Yeah, well, you know, it was worth doing, wasn't it? We managed to get in... well, we managed to play the beta before the podcast, because otherwise we would have to play it tonight, being Wednesday, and that's when it goes live, and we wouldn't be able to say these things that we're going to talk about right now.
Indeed, so, indeed.
I mean, I load it up. I'm in the desert. I felt like I was in Battlefront, buddy. It felt weird.
It looks like Battlefront, graphically.
It's all shiny.
It is Battlefield 4 skinned with Battlefront sort of game engine.
Yep.
And then skins of old weapons, but actually they behave like new ones.
Great. I mean, this is one of the issues that I clearly raised ages
ago. You did,
ago.
And I kind of played devil's advocate there, and I sort of said, well, you know, it's they can't have clunky, shoddy weapons because it's Battlefield. It has to have a certain pace about it, and it won't if the weapons are shit. But having now played it, I feel like it feels so just Battlefield franchise, like, yeah. So generic rather than a sort of unique experience like you were hoping for. It's
unique New York.
I can see where you're coming from. I really can.
And I don't know. There was such a massive thing about this being, it's all about World War One, and this doesn't feel like World War One. I mean, not that I was there, but yeah. It doesn't feel like... I mean, we played... Conquest. We played a few games of that yesterday. And I was capturing a flag. And I was like, yeah, brilliant, cool. And then suddenly, like, this kind of tank thing runs in. A fucking vehicle of some sort with a gun on the back. And a guy on a horse runs in and just, like, flattens me. And I'm like... I'm sure this happened in World War One. You know, I've seen that clip somewhere where that definitely happens.
It's very Hollywood. It's like that Lone Ranger or something.
Yeah, totally. And
there's no grit to it at all.
No, and that's the thing. It's not dirt enough, buddy. Where's the dirt?
I think we'll nip this in the bud for now, because we're going to be going into Battlefield talk a lot. We've had comments and questions this week solely related to Battlefield, but... Yeah, I suppose a nice link into...
Mate,
how
this
about
this is beautiful.
How about playing a game that does feel like World War One, buddy? How about playing a game where if you get shot, you fucking die, and the weapons are fucking terrible because it's 1914 or 12 or whatever?
Fucking sign me up, buddy. Is there trench warfare involved?
There's literal trench warfare, buddy. There's
dead horses on the floor.
There's dead everything everywhere. It's a smelly,
it's
disgusting
horrible.
Mess, buddy.
It's all
Let's
gray
head
and
into
shitty.
Authentic World War One experience that is Dead Island Syndrome 2016 Verdun.
He's going for it. He's pushing it strong, everyone. But somehow I feel like it's not going to be a winner for that syndrome. But
well, firstly, I want to congratulate. These guys for bringing their game out the same day as the Battlefield beta went
live.
Yeah,
brilliant.
Well, fair good. Play there.
I mean, who'd have thought it? Do you reckon EA did that on purpose? They were like, that's when Verdun comes out. We'll fuck them by...
No, I think the Verdun
out.
Date came out afterwards.
Oh, really? So okay.
I think they did it on purpose.
No, fair dues. So, this game is, at the moment, if you're a PS Plus subscriber, it's $11.99 on the store, and worth every penny, I would say. We played a few games. We played a co-op game, so wave-based, where loads of bad men come and charge your trench, and you have to, obviously, defend it. And this was when we kind of... This was, like, the first point in the game where we jumped in. And I was a bit confused on how tough it was, like, especially with, like, the reloading of weapons. Like, I'm used to, obviously, shooters this day in ages, like, in, out, shoot again, in, out, shoot again, bam, 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 off I go, like, just run and gun kind of thing. This is like, right, I need to reload. Like, you have to be strategic with your reloading. And stupidly, I picked a grenade as my secondary weapon. You don't want to do that. That's a bad idea.
It's not really that sort of game.
No. You definitely want a sidearm, because when you get rushed, you're going to have to pull out something quickly to finish them off, I must say. Should we talk about graphically, like, what this game's like?
Sure, yeah. I mean, this looks like a game from the era it is from. So
1914, tic-tac-toe. Imagine if that is when tic-tac-toe was made. Fuck me.
This is... It looks like an indie game. It doesn't. It's not got the budget of something like Battlefield, but graphically, it's nice looking. I think, like, it's nice and smooth looking, and the textures are nice. I mean, so much of the map is about the verticality in terms of, like, pits and craters and holes and stuff that, you know, they needed to get that right back in the day. You might have turned to some voxel technology for that, buddy, but. We've got the sort of polygon count to do it these days. I think it looks nice, to be honest, surprisingly so. And it runs reasonably well. This is a 30 frames game rather than a 60, so it does feel very different to a lot of the shooters we're used to playing. But yeah, because of the setting and the weaponry, I didn't find that detrimental. It kind of almost felt like it should be like that because of the era you're playing in and the speed at which you're fighting people. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, totally. And that's what I was looking for, buddy. We jumped into a multiplayer game. I think was it just a team deathmatch in the end? We managed to get into together.
Yeah, we had a little bit of bother with the service, but this is day one.
Not as bad as Battlefield 1943. Nope. I mean, that was bad.
We got in there in the end.
Yeah, and I picked a gun, and immediately, like, one thing I was craving was some sort of scope, because obviously iron sights from 1914 aren't that great, buddies, because, you know, guns were shit then. And so obviously you could imagine what a scope's like, pretty bad. But, you know, I managed to unlock a 3x scope, and fuck me, I had a whale of a time then. What did I go, 12-1 or something like that? I just dominated.
Yeah, you won the round. You were top scorer, not just for your team, but both. And yeah, like, the weaponry is so interesting here, isn't it?
Because definitely, I would say so.
The scope, I mean, one of the guns that I was using, the scope was like a sort of spyglass on the side of it rather than on top. And it's so interesting because it takes up a huge portion of your screen, and you have to kind of just zoom in and find a spot, zoom in, remain exposed, and sort of scan the horizon, looking for targets. Yeah. It's not like sniping in games, but the skill involved in this makes it fine. It makes it all right.
So enjoyable. So like you say, you zoom in, and then, like, you can just completely lose your bearings what you're looking at, because you're like, oh, that's not where I was aiming, you know, when I zoomed in. And then, like you say, yeah, you scare about. And it's just incredibly satisfying. Like, when you see, like, someone's head just, like, popped over something, you're like, oh, hello, I've spotted him. Oh, here we go. And bang, headshot. And it just comes up, and it's just, it's so satisfying. It's not like, like, with Battlefield and all those games, obviously, when you zoom in, it takes up the entire screen. Like, this zooms in, and, like, you're looking into, like you say, a spyglass kind of thing. But you can kind of still see your surroundings around you. So if anyone's trying to come up you quickly on your flanks and stuff, you can still spot them, which is cool. Really, really cool. I loved it.
It's great, man. Mm. I want to talk about the squad stuff as well, because although the game seemed to be struggling a little bit on day one with that, it's a really good idea. So the way that this works with regard to multiplayer gaming is that you can go into the multiplayer section, and then you can go into squads, and it will display the squads almost like if you go onto a game and you're looking at lobbies. But rather than literal lobbies, it's displaying squads specifically, four-man squads. Yeah. Anyone can create one, and you can choose whichever nationality you want to be. And then when you create that squad, there's four slots available, and you have to adhere to those. So you'll have maybe a bomber guy who's got nades or a grenade, you know, some sort of very powerful weapon. You've got your light assault, your sort of heavy gunner, and then there's like a sergeant as well who's like leading the line, scoping things out. He's got a pistol or whatever. And that's kind of how your matchmaking works. You can create a squad, invite your team in, and then when you guys ready up, then the game will search for a game to put you in as a four. And you can also join other squads that are sitting there idle. There's a list of reserve squads waiting for games, and there's a list of squads that are engaged or are loading into a map. And I think as a lobby system, that's very clever. And also kind of calculated, which suits the game. It's all very slow. If you're a fan of tactical stuff like the early Rainbow Six games, for example, something like that, then this really is for you. And I'm really hoping some more people take the plunge with this thing, buddy, because I think we could have so much fun here.
I think so too. It reminds me of some of those classic, like more realistic shooters that we used to play back in the day that kind of are just disappeared at the moment. But yeah, hopefully this is, like you say, it's going to bring it back and get everyone involved. And, you know, it's not that expensive. It's not a full price game.
12 quid. Decent modes. There's a good defense. There's a horde mode. There's a sort of conquest mode. You've got team deathmatch and normal deathmatch, and a selection of different maps. And yeah, I mean, it's a great little multiplayer game, and I'm sure we're going to be playing a lot more of it. So yeah,
Gibbons, buddy, and I think that's what we've been playing this week.
Yeah, I think that'll do us, buddy. That's a good selection there, isn't it?
We've done well. We've done really well.
And now it's time for the news.
The news.
The news. All right. Number one.
Number Wang.
Number Wang. Sony brings in two-step verification on PSN. About fucking time, you amateurs.
Yeah. Did we report on this a while ago? I can't remember if we did, because we kind of found out about it because we were like, shit, everyone's accounts are getting fucked over. Let's change all our passwords. So we did that, and yeah, you found out about the two-step verification.
Yes, it wasn't being highlighted or mentioned at all. But yeah, it was just there on the website, and it was only available on the website. You couldn't do it off of the app or the PlayStation. But
damn,
it's now officially a thing, so you can add a PIN to your account, and then depending on what you're doing, it will ask you for that PIN. Yeah, nothing much more to say about it, buddy. It's just a good thing, really. And
definitely. It makes it a bit more safer on Sony's shambolic service.
Yes.
That, you know, they want to charge more money for, because, what was it? Marketplace, whatever it is, changes. Whatever.
Yeah, no, I thought they just wanted to drive everyone over to Xbox. But yeah, no, probably that one that you're saying.
Nothing else. No. Oh, well.
Number two. Verdun delayed indefinitely on Xbox One. This is bizarre. It was delayed, the day before it came out.
Yeah.
Was it?
Yeah. Weird.
Really strange. Like, we've had this date now down for ages, and there was no word on there being big problems or anything like that. It was just, you know, here we go. Verdun's coming out, and then no, it's delayed. They haven't given a reason. There isn't a date saying when it will arrive. Obviously, you couldn't pre-order this because it didn't appear on the store until on the day, so that's not there's no sort of refund issues here or anything like that, but it's just very strange. I've been on their Twitter account today, and it's just a little bit odd. Is it M2M or something like that?
Yeah, I think it is, yeah. Something, yeah. No idea. Helpful.
Yeah, M2H games.
Yeah, totally. It stands for something.
They're being very quiet about this. I don't know what's happened, but Yeah, that probably, game hasn't come out, and no one knows when it will.
1080 at 30 frames per second, I reckon.
Yeah. It's worth mentioning, by the way, that there are some light performance issues on the PS4 version of this game that the dev have already come out and said the first patch will address, but didn't notice a great deal of problems. But once we got into that game that was like 12 on 12, I think it was. There was a tiny bit of slowdown here and there, depending on the environment. But I hope that comes out shabby, on Xbox soon.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you just don't know what's going on there because, you know, hardly anything's been said. But like you said, extremely strange, especially the word indefinitely. It worries me. I feel, what was it, the PS4 mod support for Fallout 4? I think that had the same title as well. That was like postponed indefinitely kind of thing, wasn't it? I can't remember.
I think so, yeah. I mean, yeah, you're absolutely right. The indefinitely thing is weird, and the fact that that was done the day before the game launched is really weird. Like, that thing should have been on the live servers.
Yeah, it should have been sitting there ready to go. Like, people should have... Well, if it's not a AAA game, so you wouldn't have been able to, like, pre-download it, I guess. I don't know. Maybe you could.
Can't imagine what happened there, but... either way, hopefully that'll come out soon because that game seems to be cool.
Gibbons.
We'll move on. The PS4 Slim supports 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi, not just 2.4 gigahertz like the standard PS4. Honestly, though, if you're running that console on a wireless network, you might as well be on dial-up. From my experience, I always remember bringing my PlayStation home the very first day that I got it, and obviously there was a day one firmware update, which I attempted to install over the Wi-Fi, and it said it was going to take 57 hours to download.
Yeah, you don't want to do that.
And that's, I plugged an Ethernet cable in, and it said 2 minutes.
That's so better. Always wire your shit up. Known fact.
Pretty weird. It was very, very strange thing to skimp on originally until you realized that the Wi-Fi was utterly useless, so it didn't matter if it was 2.4 or 5. But yeah, it'll be interesting. I don't know how easy it'll be to find out without actually getting one and trying it, but it'll be interesting to see how much better the range is and the speeds and stuff on that thing when the Slim is officially launched rather than just occasionally
just sold
on Gumtree.
On the black market, yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's like you say, I just thought it was weird that it wasn't already in the first place. And also, yes, Wi-Fi is wank, so don't use it.
Gibbons.
It's fine for your phone and browsing internet, not for downloading like 40 gig games.
No, or ruining other people's experiences in death matches.
That's true. No one likes that.
Yeah. I got a lot of that on Titanfall over the weekend.
Did you play some more of it? I didn't, because obviously I wasn't here.
Just a little bit. Not enough to really talk about, same as last time, really. Just, yeah. It's Black Ops with
I was excited about that game. I'm not now, unfortunately. Mm.
The shooters seem to be kind of letting us down a little bit, to be honest. Apart from Verdun, buddy.
Apart from Verdun, buddy. Great game.
Syndrome 2016. Next, we move on. Gran Turismo Sport delayed until next year because it looked absolute shithouse. Obviously, that was me. I've put that on there. That's not a report from a website. Although
official statement of Sony.
Yep. We thought this looked like absolute fucking ball bags, so we decided to delay it into next year to try and make it not look terrible.
It's a good shout.
That's kind of what's going on there. Very unimpressed everyone was when they showed the footage off of that, and I was very surprised when that was announced for this autumn, fall, whatever you like. I'm glad it's been delayed, but it doesn't sound long enough to me in terms of making it worth buying.
Yeah, if they're going to actually do or change anything about it, yeah, I feel like they might need a bit more time, but who knows?
I just don't know. Either way, I was obviously very interested in that because I'm a massive racing fan, but I'm glad it's been delayed. This is the week when Assetto Corsa launched and has launched to terrible reviews. We're talking fours and fives.
Out of five.
Due to like a shambolic launch full of slowdown, screen tear, lack of content, and the announcement of like a £30 season pass all at the same time.
Sign me up.
Not great. Thankfully, we've got F1 to tide us over. But yes, hopefully GT will come back bigger and stronger next year and look like something someone might want to buy, because it didn't when I saw it before.
That will happen, buddy. Unfortunately. I don't know, like, what else? What other racing games are knocking about apart from those two at the moment? I can't really
fuck
think
all
of
on the PlayStation, buddy. I mean, Forza Horizon's just gone gold for Xbox. We would have totally got on board with that if we were on that console.
Yeah, I mean, I could still get it on PC, buddy.
But yeah, other than that, slim pickings on the old PlayStation at the moment.
Shitbag.
I have got more racing news.
Ooh, nice.
This one is more of, well, it's not really a racing game, this, so. But yes, it's a shooty bang bang racing game, some sort of deathmatch racing game. This is like Gas it. Guzzlers Extreme. And that's been announced to be coming to consoles in quarter two next year. This is your sort of vigilante type racing stroke destruction derby gun mounted machine gun turret bullshit going on, which is always good, usually good fun. And it's out on Steam already and to decent critical reviews and looks like a cool game, buddy. I watched some footage of it earlier and looks right up our alley. So that could be one to look out for.
My question, does it need extreme after it? I mean, Gas Guzzlers, that's already quite an extreme name. Do we need Gas Guzzlers Extreme?
I think it's some sort of like a best of edition or something.
Oh, okay. So this is Gas Guzzlers like 2.5.
Yeah, I believe so. It's like a sort of new game plus type thing. So it's got like I think the original game was called Gas Guzzlers, and this is the extreme version featuring their DLC packs, which I think were called like Full Metal Frenzy and Full Metal Zombie or something like that.
Ah, I love zombies.
But yeah, this is going to have like 12, 12 modes, 40-odd tracks, 20-odd cars, like 12
See,
different
that's
weapons.
That's good content, buddy. That's what you want.
Yeah, it's the full game and all the DLC packs. Always up for that sort of thing. Very much up our alley, especially on game nights and stuff.
Cool, buddy. Sounds like we'll buy it.
No specific date yet on that, but Q2 next year suggests sort of May, June time. So hopefully we'll see it then.
Cool, buddy.
But yeah, a shortage of news this week from me, buddy. So that's me done. I think it's time to head over into Ash's News Favourite Things of the Week.
If you like news but hate information, you have found the right place. Ash's News Favourite Thing of the Week.
Cheers, buddy. And first on the list is the news that tic-tac-toe was actually first played in the Roman Empire around the 1st century in BC. So my guess of 1914 was fucking miles off.
Just missed it, mate.
I felt I had it there.
Close.
Next, yeah, we've already spoken about it. Hitman Complete first season coming to retail January 31st. Will I have it before then? Probably.
How's the fucking Luli, buddy?
So our adventures into JRPGs, buddy. Persona 5. Got a little bit of news on that for you.
Ooh!
Apparently it's going to have some sort of online feature, aka a la Bloodborne style, where you can pop in and help your buddy out.
That sounds perfect for our first JRPG, buddy.
I know, right? I don't know about you, but I was a big fan of the Battlefield 1 event at the EA whatever E3 press conference thing, whatever they did. They didn't do that. Was it a thing before that? I don't know. Who knows? And anyway, Snoop Dogg and Wiz Khalifa are back, but this time they are headlining the Call of Duty XP celebration event, so there'll be all the drugs there.
Fucking, so he's done the Battlefield launch, yep, and now he's doing the COD
he's
launch.
He's doing COD as well.
He don't give a shit, does he?
He don't care, mate. He's Snoop Dogg. D-O-double-G.
Well, Well, fair play, I suppose.
Now, I know that our, you know, PS4 community is rife with people right now. Good news, buddy.
Thriving it is.
It's overflowing right now with people. But luckily now, buddy, PS4 communities can support up to 100,000 members. So fucking get in there quick. They're going to fill
Jesus.
Up.
Because we did our limit a long time ago. So thank God for that, buddy. That's such a weight off my shoulders. I feel so much better now.
Gibbons, buddy. Me too. And finally, probably my news favouritest thing of the week. Don't Starve Together hits PS4 in September.
Ooh, that's not long.
That is not long, buddy. As in, it's September right now, if you're listening to this on a Sunday. Any Sunday.
Any given Sunday.
Any given Sunday in September.
Yep.
So yeah, we'll be able to get Don't Starve Together in September, buddy.
And is that going to be like an add-on pack for Don't Starve, or is it
sure.
a standalone release?
Totally, buddy. Both.
Do you not know?
I don't know. It says alongside a digital bundle. So I'm guessing you can buy it individually or as a pack. I didn't read the article. I saw the headline. I was like, sweet. That's
standalone,
great for my section.
Standalone on Steam, so probably standalone on the consoles as well.
Probably.
Okay, well, that's great news. I look forward to playing that game because I completely overdosed on like 100 episodes of that on Sips's YouTube channel, Sips of the Yogscast, and it meant that I never actually had the urge to physically play the game. I'd seen like 50 hours of it and had no desire to see any more or play any of it, but I would certainly be up for it with you, so yeah, that's going
to
be really
I'm
good.
I'm going to have to break the rules of information giving right now, buddy. I'm sorry about this, but yes, players who already own the original Don't Starve on PS4 can pick up Don't Starve Mega Pack for 60% off the launch price. Don't Starve Together and Don't Starve Mega Pack will launch digitally via the PlayStation Network on September 13th. I'm sorry, it had to be done. I thought that was
nice.
Actual news bringing there.
That's not bad. We're only a week or two away from that. That's beautiful news. And,
yeah. I'll
that
save
was
some pennies for that.
PS Plus, wasn't it? So most people should have
so,
that.
Anyone that has it should have it, which is good news.
Very nice, too. Nice, buddy. Well, thanks for all of that.
You are welcome, buddy.
Beautiful. That's Ash's news and my news. That was the news. And now it's time for Fonz or Phoenix.
So what have we got this week, buddy? In, out, up, down, left, right, roundabout, yin, yang... North, south, have I done that? Oh gosh, I'm so... there's too many opposites.
I am so lost.
I just don't know where I am. So, Fonz or Phoenix, buddy, where are we?
It's one of those wonderful moments, buddy, where the Fonz or Phoenix is completely nothing to do with the news. It's just the fact that I choose it, and this is something I like, and therefore we have a Fonz.
Nice, buddy. I like a good Fonz. It cheers me up.
Well, Gibbons, buddy, I think you're going to like this one. I think a lot of people are. This is the news that Wreckfest is coming to consoles. This is a car game from Bugbear. I think they're most famous for the Flat Out series, which launched... I think the original Flat Out launched on PS2. I had it on my gaming PC back when I had that decent graphics card. And those games were fantastic. Flat Out 2, Ultimate Carnage, I think it was called.
Yeah.
They're basically like banger racing games, a mixture of tarmac and gravel. They've got sort of Destruction Derby-esque arenas as well. The big selling point was always the physics engine because it had realistic damage. Everything could kind of fall off of the car, and all of the gravity physics and everything were very realistic. And they showed those off with a selection of almost like Olympic games for... so they'd have like an arena and there was a high jump. One of the funniest game mechanics with this game was you could actually like fire the driver through the windshield, and that kind of forged a selection of game modes like long jump and high jump.
High
they
jump
literally
was,
made arenas,
and
was
you could so much fun, weren't they?
Yeah, it was brilliant. Ones with like you threw him down for like skittles and that sort of thing. so yeah, I think they lost their publisher a little while ago, a few years back, and they started working on a new racing game, but it didn't look like, you know, as a small indie, it didn't really look like that was something that they could get off the ground for consoles and so on. And they ended up doing a Kickstarter, which was very successful. They called it Next Car Game at the time, and it was one of these sort of Kickstarters done right, where they had the proof of concept available for download before you even parted with your cash. So you had a sort of
early
demo
to
play. You know, the pedigree was there anyway for all to see. They've gone through that sort of standard modern development route on Steam, and Wreckfest is now available on Steam and has done reasonably well on PC, and they've decided it's time to bring it to consoles. The good news is, if you trust this developer, which I certainly do, I've liked everything they've released before and I can see what they've done on PC, is you can pre-order this now off of their website, independently of the Sony store or the Xbox Live store. You can just go to the Bugbear website and pre-order this, the full version of this game, for $20 worldwide.
I mean, that's pretty good.
There's a couple of different
packages.
That sounds
like a bargain.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously you are... there's an element of risk there in the same way as if you were to kickstart something, in that I know that the game exists and is real and they're a good dev, but they do have to port it and get it working and it needs to get on the console, which is probably why the price is what it is. But I'm just really excited. I loved Flat Out. One of my favorite moments, I think it was Flat Out 2 on the PS2, friend of the podcast, Paul, We were pissed up playing that game. We were taking it in turns to do the time trials in the quickest possible time. And there was a specific map which involved you flying through a field, up a bridge, and then under a tunnel. And it was kind of a loop. And he completely caned, just came back into the room, hit go, and put in the fastest lap of all time. Like on the leaderboards. He just number one on that track ever. I don't know if it was beaten. Maybe it was, maybe it wasn't. This was several months into the release of the game. It wasn't like early doors or anything.
But
he just put the fastest fucking lap in, just topped the leaderboard, like blind drunk on a Friday night. Fair enough.
That was done. Yeah. I don't feel they'd have that much joy doing that on F1.
No, I don't think so. Probably not. But yeah, anyway, that's it from me, buddy. Sounds like something might be up your alley. You've played Flat Out before, haven't you?
Yeah, I had it on the PC, and like the main things that I remember were those that mini game area, and with the high jump and the long jump, and it was just incredibly funny. And like you say, like the ragdoll physics and stuff like that were awesome.
There was a game mode on there where you fired your gazer. You went up a ramp and then fired him through a flaming ring into darts, where you just shot your driver at a big bullseye.
Yeah, and that to me is just a fun game.
Yeah,
you know?
you can check this out if you search Wreckfest on YouTube. Obviously, this is out on Steam, so there's plenty of gameplay here, so you can have a good look at this. I have no doubt that we will pre-order this, especially with the family sharing setup we've got. But yes, it's a Fonz from me, buddy, for Wreckfest from Bugbear.
Nice, buddy.
And it looks like early next year, Q1 next year, looks like the release for it.
Nice.
And now it's time for Out This Week.
And that's Out This Week. Yes.
So, first off the bat, buddy, We've got the PS Plus lineup. If you remember, the Tuesday
just
fell.
Though, I mean, yep. they were holding on to that tightly.
They were. Yeah, it didn't come through till late. But yeah, we had our Xbox Games 4 Gold last week, and that was pretty poor, to be honest. Good games, but old games.
Yeah, true.
Anyway, we have the PS Plus lineup for September, and here we go. On PS4, we have Lords of the Fallen and Journey. On the cross-play title for PS4, PS3, and PS Vita is Badland. We have Prince of Persia Forgotten Sands on the PS3, and the Vita gets Amnesia Memories. There we go, buddy. What do you make of all that?
I'm glad about Journey because it's one of those games that I've wanted to play and just never got around to buying. Like, several times it's been in the sale and I'm like, oh yeah, I'll buy that, and then just, you know, never do. But now I don't have to buy it, buddy, because it's part of my PlayStation Plus subscription. Good news for me. But obviously, God knows how many people have bought that game in the sales, you know, and like, I kind of feel like that's a bit of a dick move putting Journey in there.
Again, yeah, you're absolutely right. I think we're in a very tiny minority of people who haven't played Journey. I'm obviously very excited about it, but I would suspect 9 out of 10 people listening to this aren't because they've played it.
Totally.
I think bigger news, Lords of the Fallen. That's a AAA game, and
you can't argue
with it. We've been asking for a while, and this is, I think, widely regarded a sort of Dark Souls clone. I'm looking forward to giving it a go. It's that's the sort of game I think they should be giving us on PS Plus.
By now, you know, 3 years into the cycle, or nearly 3 years, and this is the type of game that should be coming out in the PlayStation Plus. You're right. Yeah,
I hope it's them turning over a new leaf there, because I think certainly with the price hike that's coming in stateside and looks to be possibly coming in over here.
Totally.
They really need to do this. So that's good news. The crossplay title Badland is actually a mobile tablet game that's been ported over.
Yeah, was it 2013's iPad of the Year game?
It's like the speedrun levels on Rayman kind of thing. I think that's kind of what you're looking at here. I'll give it a go.
We'll play it.
Obviously, because of where it's come from, it looks more suited to the Vita, and perhaps you'll have more joy with it on there. But
indeed.
Prince of Persia Forgotten Sands, PS3, very old game, good one.
Yeah, old game, that
really
is.
Old. But I remember playing through that and enjoying it, so that's something.
I think I had that on PC at the time.
Yeah, I think I did as well. And then Amnesia Memories, fair enough, you know, Vita, here we are, kind of thing. It's a good month. It's a good month. One of the best months for some time, although Tricky Towers is standing over PlayStation Plus like a shining beacon of joy.
It's beautiful. Beautiful
looking
game.
Down upon Lords of the Fallen, among others. But yes, there we go. Other games coming out this week, we have Mother Russia Bleeds on the PC, Mac, and Linux. This is It's a Streets of Rage type game, and it looks really cool. Like, it's got great animation, it's kind of got lots of different moves, it's very smooth and cartoony and interesting, but it's local only, and this is not a console game, so local only on PC, Mac, and Linux, that's not the best, is it, really? I don't know if I'm being weird there, I just don't really feel like PC is often a sort of crowd round the system kind of platform, and so a game like this being couch co-op, I don't know, maybe I'm living in the past, maybe lots of people have PCs under their TVs now in their living rooms, but seems a bit odd to me.
Gibbons, buddy, I can totally understand what you're saying.
We've also got Space Rangers Quest on the PC, which is a retro nostalgic text adventure set in space. We have Awesome Noughts Assemble on the Xbox One. It's Awesome Noughts. I think most people know what that is. Kind of a 2D side-scrolling MOBA, I suppose, would be a good way to describe it. It's been out on PC for a long time, PlayStation 4 for some time as well. But that's joining up with Xbox One this week. We have Dogos or Dogos, depending on how you pronounce that. That's coming out on the PS4. And the Xbox One a few days later, and it is a top-down shoot 'em up a la Power Strike, which was a Master System game that I loved. So that's quite cool. So it's like, it's like one of these top-down shoot 'em ups of old, but it's on sort of a 360-degree axis, so you can spin round and go everywhere in a sort of Desert Strike kind of way. So there's that.
Okay.
We've got Just Sing coming out on Xbox One and PS4, which is a karaoke game from Ubisoft, from the sort of Just Dance franchise. This is a Just Sing, so cool. 40 songs with the launch there, and hundreds more to buy for money.
Yay!
The Legend of Heroes, Trails of Cold Steel 2, is out on the PS3 and PS Vita. This is an RPG, like an old-school RPG. It's a bit strange that it's coming out on the PS3 and Vita.
Yeah, that is weird.
Odd to see a new game launching on the PS3 and Vita specifically and nothing else. But
I don't get that. That's weird.
Bit strange. The Tomorrow Children is coming out on PS4. This is the most interesting-looking release of the week. This is like a sort of weird... It's got a bit of Minecraft about it, and it's like a town simulator, but it's also multiplayer. So it's kind of third person as well, which is very strange looking. And you can kind of build a town with people online, but as I understand it, there aren't sort of private lobbies, so you'll need to find people who are willing to work with you. Doing a bit of research about the multiplayer on this game, I just found lots of people ranting about how they were trying to build like a fire station and everyone had taken all the iron or something. I don't know. It's really weird, this game. I think it's going to be one of the ones that people talk about a hell of a lot.
Yeah.
And I think you'll see a lot of features and people talking about this on podcasts. It might be something we need to have a look at, because I think it could be, this could blow up this week. Although that terrible looking game that I said last week would blow up, I haven't heard anything about it since.
So. Yeah, either way, happen, buddy.
The Tomorrow Children.
I think you should just predict each week one game to explode, and you know the odds are in your favour. Then
it'll happen eventually. Maybe this time around, buddy. The Tomorrow Children.
I think you've got it this time, buddy.
Yeah. And finally this week, Unbox comes out on PC. This is a weird-looking, fun, exploration, cartoony thing where you play as a cardboard box with a face. It's also got some multiplayer modes. It's very colourful and very hard to see exactly how it works from videos, which is the only research I've been able to do on it. But either way, that's out this week on PC. Unbox, play as a cardboard box, buddy, bounce about... Maybe ping off a ceiling fan, put a tash on, maybe some green hair. You get the idea. Or not. I don't know. But there we go. That's okay. Out this week.
That's out this week, buddy.
And now it's time for the JFG Top 5.
So what's the top five this week, buddy? What have we got?
Well, in the spirit of the Battlefield 1 open beta and the fantastical game Verdun, buddy.
I love Verdun.
Seems like an excellent time to look into war games. So this is going to be a top five list of World War 1 or 2 games. Little caveat in there, because... a lot of these games had sort of expansion packs here and there that kind of delved into a previous war. That kind of was a popular thing to do with some of the older games here. So
yeah.
So yeah, I think I mainly put this list together. I think you agree with most of it, though. Is that fair to say?
I'll go along with, yeah, yeah. I'll go along with that. That looks
excellent
good.
News. So in no particular order, number one, Call of Duty 2, which I believe is the best Call of Duty game ever released. Is certainly the best. The first three Call of Duties tackled World War II, and I think it's the best of those.
Yeah, definitely.
Ships all over World at War as well, although not hard. But yeah, Call of Duty 2, buddy, I think it was the first one that really stepped up to the plate and kind of took on Medal of Honor, which it's easy to forget was the bigger franchise
it was
back in the day.
And yeah, you're totally right. Call of Duty 2, I spoke about this last week or the week before. You know, I gave the sub story about how it was stolen.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Bastards.
Motherfuckers, buddy. Never finished that game. But yeah, it was, like I said, one of the first games I got my 360, so I was like, oh, the power, the glory of all this 3D environments. It looked amazing. And yeah, it had shit guns, buddy, which is what war's all about.
It's what you need. It had amazing scenarios, and it had lots of real footage from wars, a kick-ass voiceover. It was all very somber and serious. There was no running gun bullshit, you know?
Totally. And definitely needs to be in our top five World War One or Two games, buddy.
Gibbon. Number two, I've chucked in Blazing Angels.
Good choice, buddy.
Could have picked a lot of different flight sims here. This is probably the most arcadey one that you could pick, but had masses of fun with this game. It is a 360 we had it on, and it was a really good campaign mode with lots of missions. The multiplayer was excellent.
I was going to say that's where it stepped up for me. That multiplayer did we get the second one? I can't remember.
Well, we did, but it was very close to the arrival of the new consoles. Yeah. I've actually got Blazing Angels 2. Funk actually got it for me off eBay for like peanuts and sent it down to me as a present, which was lovely of him.
Yeah.
But we never actually all got online to play it before the new consoles.
So it must have been the original one. I just remember flying through the Eiffel Tower, buddy.
It was as much fun flying about with your buddies as it was actually dogfighting or taking on missions on that
totally.
Game.
It was good.
Kind of arcadey. It was just really fun and easy to play.
Mm. Heavenly, buddy. Sorry, I'm drinking beer. You know how it goes.
Can happen.
Probably one of my favorite ones, this next one. Battlefield 1943. This holds a special place in my heart for God knows whatever reason. It was so simple. Three different classes. Once again, the guns, they felt old. And, you know, like that bolt action rifle, it was a solid gun. And when you shot someone, they were going to die within two shots, definitely.
It was a strange game, this, because if you think back, it's most famous for being one of the worst launches of any game of all time.
Yeah.
Which it overcame eventually.
Overcame.
But it felt cartoony and had a sort of Pirates of the Caribbean-esque sort of soundtrack, and it looked kind of cartoony as well. But in terms of the actual, you know, your hit points and stuff, it was very simulation and it had a mixture of stuff here, and it all just kind of worked. And it always felt to me like it was the sort of game that shouldn't work, but absolutely did. It had cracking maps, loads of diversity.
Awesome.
It was really fun. This game was really fun.
Yeah, and that's all it needed to be. You know, I didn't use a lot of the vehicles and stuff in there, mainly just the Jeep to fucking get from one point to the other as quickly as I could. But, you know, this game, It didn't have that like fast-paced, ridiculously fast-paced kind of feel that Battlefield does now, and that's why I loved it so much.
And it felt, because it was slower and more calculated, it kind of felt like it had more balance than the new Battlefields. Like I don't remember on 1943 getting really fucked off because I kept like running for ages and then dying in the same spot. Like it was hard to hold positions, and you know, someone could parachute in and take out a whole squad. It was just balanced really nicely in a sort of arcadey fashion where it was the emphasis was 100% on fun, and that was quite clear to see.
Totally, buddy. It was awesome.
So going from that to something very contrasting to that, and you've let me have this. I don't know if you played this or not. Did you ever play Commandos?
I don't remember playing it, but possibly. Who knows? There's so many games that I've played that I just don't remember.
This was a... I think it was strictly PC, although don't quote me on that. It was a sort of SAS environmental sort of game. So you picked a couple of soldiers. Maybe you had a scenario where you needed to infiltrate a base or whatever. It was like a sort of isometric kind of view, and it was point and click, so you kind of selected units like a sort of RTS and moved them around. You could sneak up on people, you had like the option to right click to stab someone, you could cause diversions, you had certain objectives. It was very slow paced, very tense. It had a fog of war thing going on, so that you couldn't always tell, like, if you were out in the open whether maybe someone could see you or not. Very uncompromising, but then, you know, it was a war game, so it kind of made sense. They made several of these, several sequels, and they still run well now, and they're still worth playing. I actually was playing a bit of Commandos a few weeks ago on my mum's old ancient PC. So I highly recommend this game. It's kind of a choice of mine, but
sorry. In the chat, JJ's like, fuck Commandos.
Is JJ not a fan of Commandos?
Looks that way, buddy. Looks that way.
What's his beef with that wonderful title?
I'm sure we'll find out in a bit. So we'll pop on to the final one of the five. And like you said, buddy, Medal of Honor was one of the big games back in the day. Kind of just died slowly and quietly, unfortunately, when Call of Duty kind of picked up the paces and Battlefield kind of ramped up as well. And the one we're talking about is Allied Assault. And I mainly remember playing this LAN with about four of us in my flat on various laptops and PCs.
Well, this was the one. This was the war game from my childhood. And Call of, as you say, Call of Duty took over. But Allied Assault, the way that it was put together, there was something about it. There was a certain magic there. And it had all of those scenarios. It felt big budget. And yeah, like as a LAN game, you couldn't really beat it. It was fantastic.
It was awesome. So much fun.
I think COD kind of stands up better looking back on them. I think it was the prettier game, especially Call of Duty 2. But
yeah, I think so.
I think it's fair to put Allied Assault in there. Like, you can't really have this top five list without it. And I don't think it's talked about very much these days. I think it inspired a lot of stuff that came afterwards. So it seems a little bit odd that it's not really kind of lauded more. But we're doing that exact thing, buddy, with our top five list.
Gibbons, buddy. And obviously there's fucking hundreds of war games out there, and you know, if you think that we're wrong like JJ, then let us know. Get in contact with us. You know, we're always
maybe tell us to fuck off, or that we're wrong, or you know, something like that. Maybe a DDoS attack would be a good idea. Who knows?
Yeah, Gibbons, buddy. But yeah, I would say that's our favorite top five.
JJ says, like you said, completely unforgiving, and you have to have patience, which I don't. That's what he said.
Well, fair dues, buddy.
Someone's been fucked over by Commandos, buddy, and they're not happy about it. But yeah, it was very much... I think Commandos can best be described as like a dad game, but when we were little, you know? Like, when I was 12 is the sort of game that if you were like 35 to 50, then you'd be like, yeah, this is kind of, you know, I've settled down. I've got kids now running about, and it's time for me to very carefully infiltrate Nazi Germany.
Sounds like my kind of game.
There we go. Anyway, that's our top five. Call of Duty 2, Blazing Angels, Battlefield 1943, Commandos, and Medal of Honor Allied Assault.
Nice, buddy.
And now it's time for Many Moons Ago.
Many Moons Ago.
When are we going, buddy? When are we going?
We couldn't really help but do this because of the special place this game holds in our hearts here at the JfG podcast. This is the 6th of September 2011.
Ooh, what a time to be alive.
What a time to be alive, buddy, when you could go out and, if you'd pre-ordered it because it was sold out fucking everywhere for weeks, pick up everyone's favourite Deep Silver game from Techland. It's Dead Island.
Ah, what a game.
What a game.
What a game.
Let's talk about Dead Island, buddy. The original benefactor of Dead Island Syndrome. The creator, if you will.
Yeah, totally.
What did you think of Dead Island?
At the time, I was amazed by it. You know, it was four-player co-op zombie slasher where you could craft a medley of weapons out of useless shit you find along your way. It was just loads of fun, buddy. It was a lovely, pretty environment as well, you know. Not desert island, but, you know, a tropical resort or what have you. And, yeah, buddy. It was loads of fun. I never finished it, though, unfortunately, which was a shame.
It was kind of like a B movie game, which I quite liked about it. So it was ropey. I mean, originally the first time that I came into contact with this in any way was an incredible trailer. If you never saw it, then head onto YouTube and check out the original Dead Island reveal trailer, because it has nothing to do with Dead Island in any way.
True,
but it is one of the most amazing trailers I've ever seen, and it stirred up a massive amount of hype, which was, I mean, these days we'd probably call it dishonest, because
I could think of another game that did that.
Oh yeah,
would that be No Man's Sky, buddy?
Well, that can happen.
Does that mean that, you know, that's the kind of on a par for Dead Island Syndrome now?
No, you can't squeeze that in there in any way. And it's also worth noting that No Man's Sky, regardless of what they claimed that it did, all of its trailers were gameplay, buddy. So so no, fuck off with your attempts at Dead Island Syndrome.
Just saying.
Everyone knows it's Verdun. So
We shall see.
That ship has sailed. But yes, this was a ropey game from a studio that were fairly inexperienced. There were a lot of bugs and glitches, but it was the only AAA release for about 8 weeks, and everyone lapped it up. It had co-op in there, which was the most important thing, because, you know, that was it was a huge novelty, and the crafting system was commendable, and the graphics engine wasn't bad either. I mean, even for the time. I think this game got a lot of shit that it didn't deserve, and I think mainly it... No, stick with me here, buddy.
Okay, I'm there. Teach me your ways.
I genuinely feel that the biggest problem that they had was how terrible the acting was. And I think that if the acting had been accomplished, then people might have looked past some of the technical deficiencies that were there. I think
you mean like one of the characters not having pants on?
I mean, that doesn't help, obviously. But yeah. The script and the acting were appalling, and... It kind of made a mockery of everything, but we ended up enjoying it for that. Like, sometimes the challenge were... I mean, I remember getting halfway through that game and someone getting stuck. No, we had to take out some big zombie, and we accidentally drove a vehicle into him and pushed him through... We clipped him through a wall into a barn.
Yeah,
and we couldn't get him. We couldn't get in that barn. And
no.
We were standing there for ages trying to like throw projectiles right near the wall to kind of take him out like that. And
yep.
I mean, when we did it, and I think it was you actually managed to pop a nade right on the sort of side of the wall there and take him out, or Funk maybe axed him through the wall because there was a lot of clipping problems.
Yeah, there were some issues.
And it was amazing.
Satisfying game, buddy. And that's the thing, like, hacking those limbs off was fucking awesome. Like, seriously, like, I could do that for hours, and I did do that for hours, just running around with various machetes and just hacking away, buddy. It was so good. And like, it makes me feel like I want to play Dying Light, because we played the demo of that quite a bit. But, you know, maybe we should just pick it up one day and just be like, yeah, sweet. Maybe it's time to return to some zombie loving.
It could well be. I mean, it had a lot of content, Dead Island and Dying Light. I mean, Funk's got Dying Light, hasn't he? And he highly recommends it. He's tried to get us to pick it up a couple of times. But it's... Dying Light is an example of how far they've come, and also kind of shows that their intentions were kind of valiant and good. They just hadn't really got there as a studio yet in terms of... scope, expertise, size, budget, and so on. But looking back at Dead Island, I think it was a, you know, amazing, really amazing time for that studio that they managed to release this game that, I mean, if that launches on Steam as an indie title, then people kind of take the piss, I think.
Yeah,
but
true.
What they had on their hands was the number one in the games charts for something like 8-9 weeks.
Yeah, it was crazy. It really was. It was absolutely crazy. They did really well.
It was mental. And yeah, as we've said, it's spawned a whole thing as far as we're concerned, Dead Island Syndrome, where, you know, a game launches with nothing around it and becomes incredibly successful. Certain Sniper Elite games have managed to pull it off in the past, and don't know, man. It's pretty crazy, but I've got very fond memories of Dead Island, and it wasn't the best game ever. It was the definition of a 7 out of 10 game, but we had masses of fun on
that moment, buddy. Came at that perfect moment.
It did. That was the 6th of September, 2011, which saw the release of a game I travelled 30 miles in my car to pick up secondhand for full price.
Crazy.
At Blockbuster Video, the mighty Dead Island.
It's beautiful.
And now it's time for the JFG quiz.
So, buddy, this week we have another audio quiz.
As it should be, buddy. Beautiful stuff. I'm very excited.
So this week we're going to be looking at various sound effects within computer games, or video games, as you were. So I've picked 5 random games from time and picked out some various sounds that I've managed to find on YouTube and various other places. And so, yeah, you're going to try and guess what game they're from, buddy. If you want. So if you've got your finger on the trigger or whatever, are you ready?
I think I am, yeah. They're so little that I think I can play them out the drive without even downloading them. So
there you go. Yeah, they're literally only like a second long. So I'm going to try and do this for the live stream as well. Hopefully it will work. We shall see. Enjoy. Question number 1. Do you need to play that again?
I've got it.
Yeah? Okay. So your multiple choice answers are, is it the Mario coin sound? Is it Aladdin grabbing them apples? Or is it Sonic collecting those rings?
That'd be Sonic collecting those rings, buddy.
That would be Sonic. A nice easy one to start you off, I thought there.
Yeah.
Number 2, are you ready?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Is
It's a long one, this. A couple of seconds long. Do you want to listen to it again?
Oh, that takes me back, buddy. No, I think I've got it. Bring it on.
Okay. Is this your shield recharging in Halo? Is it Splinter Cell turning on your night vision? Or is it Killzone charging up your sniper rifle?
That's Splinter Cell all the way, buddy.
It is Splinter Cell all the way. That's two for two, buddy. It's a beautiful sound, that, isn't it?
I love that sound. I really hope Ironside's back for the next one.
Oh, Gibbons, buddy. Number three, are you ready?
Yeah.
Do you need that again?
That's harder.
Ooh, yeah, I thought you might struggle with this one. Okay, do you want to... Should we go for it? You ready?
Yeah, give me the options.
Okay, is it A, Overwatch, where you go through your little teleporter thing? Is it B, Half-Life 2's gravity gun? Or is it C, the portal gun? From Portal. Obviously.
It's not B. I'm going Portal.
Going for Portal Gun?
Yeah.
He's got it 3 for 3. Nice, oh, buddy. He's doing good.
Oh, God.
He's doing good. Number 4. Are you ready?
Yes.
Here we go. One more time, buddy.
Again, I feel like I'll know this when you give me the possible answers. I think so.
Is it A, Crash Bandicoot spinning? Is it B, Mario Kart 64 getting hit by a green shell? Or is it C, Bugs Bunny and Taz in Time Buster, where Taz spins around?
I think it's Crash. I'm going to go Crash.
Yeah? You're going to go Crash?
Yeah.
It is, buddy. Is Crash Bandicoot spinning round?
I think I only got that because of Uncharted.
Yeah. That's what I thought. I was like, even if he didn't play the old ones, he definitely played it in Uncharted. He'd get this.
Yeah. I think that's why I got that.
Okay, buddy. Last one. Are you ready?
Yes.
Do you want to do that one more time?
Oh, God. Okay.
Okay. Is this Mario getting a one-up? Is it Mario getting the mushroom that makes him really big? Or is it Mario at the finishing flag of the level?
One-up.
Are you sure?
No, but I'm going one-up.
He's done it, buddies. 5 for 5.
Come
nicely
on.
Done. Well played, buddy.
Nice, buddy. I liked that.
Yeah, it was a nice short one. Like, it's hard to find sound effects on the internet.
I'm sure. Not without trawling through hours of video anyway.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, there you go, buddy. There's some sound effects from games from the past. I feel like we could do more of these. And yeah. It was fun.
Yeah, I think that's going to be our thing from now on, buddy. And I think we might need to do a quiz edition of the podcast, like a one-off special. Yeah, yeah.
Wow. That's a lot of questions.
It is, but it'd be really fun.
Gibbons, buddy. Well, nicely done and well played.
Cheers, buddy. As JJ has mentioned in the chat, I'm pleased that I did not Mortal Kombat that particular quiz.
He would never forget that. He would never forget that.
Never live it down.
It's true. I did love my remix of that song.
Gorgeous. Cheers, buddy.
Cool.
And now it's time for Fuckwit Corner.
Fuckwit Corner with Funk. Fuckwit Corner with Funk. he's got some questions for Ben. Fuck.
So he got some questions for us this week, buddy.
Funk's got some Battlefield-related cheeky question for us here. Just a little rundown of how he feels about things. And JJ actually contacted us this week with talk of very, very similar sort of outlook on things. So I kind of thought it was worth popping JJ into Fuckwit Corner. Some sort of JJ-esque Fuckwit Corner. Fuckwit Corner. It's the Indian version, buddy.
I like it.
Anyway, yes, JJ's in Fuckwit Corner this week. He's making a cameo. Here he is. But firstly, Funk begins with this. Funk says, I had a crack at the Battlefield 1 beta. It's quite good fun. I had a go at Conquest, gooned about in a biplane, rode a boot on a horse, had a go at Rush mode, which is my personal favourite Battlefield mode. I had a gay old time, but I couldn't help feeling like it was basically just DLC. I was hoping the weaponry would be a bit more clunky, slow firing style as it should be for a war that had almost no personal machine guns to be seen. What I saw instead was the same submachine gun stroke assault rifle stroke LMG loadouts, which surely makes a mockery of placing the game in World War One or brackets International Civil War III. It just all felt a bit blurg. I might be getting old, but I'm a bit fed up with it all, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, yes. Yes, indeed, buddy.
I agree with everything that you've said there. We were talking last night, I think, about Battlefield and about Verdun, and we were trying to decide how Funk would feel about these things.
Yeah.
Because we know that he's a big Battlefield fan, but both of us kind of feel a little bit disenfranchised from it, certainly this open beta. And then we picked up Verdun, and it felt very refreshing for a lot of the reasons that Funk's kind of listed there. My problem with Battlefield 1 is that changing the era like they have made me very excited for it, because I expected it to be
something
unique
new.
In some way, different.
Yeah. Totally, not like a modern shooter at all.
I just don't think that they've got it right. I think that it feels like Battlefield 4. It feels like Battlefield 4 running in the Battlefront engine with skinned old weapons, but they're too good, the weapons, and it's very fast paced, and it doesn't feel remotely like World War One. And having played Verdun this week, which, you know, whether it's clunky because it's a cheap indie title or because it's set in the World War One,
it
feels
other,
more authentic, doesn't it?
Yeah, totally.
Than Battlefield does.
It feels fucking tense as fuck, that game does. You know, whereas Battlefield's like the standard run for 5 minutes and get killed, or be better than me at Battlefield, you know, isn't hard.
So you're kind of in agreement here, are you?
Oh, totally. Yeah, I agree with everything you're saying there. Like, I don't know. I feel like it's mocking World War One. You know,
and you were the first to mention the weaponry and stuff, weren't you? Originally,
yeah, totally. And it's been my worry all the way through, and it has come to a rise, or whatever the fucking saying is. You know, it's a fact now that my worries have come true, which isn't good.
I think there's a parallel there. Like, we were talking earlier, and I was saying about PES and how I wasn't convinced in the slightest that should be something we part cash with, you know, for. And it sounds the Funk as a... I'm a big fan of PES. Funk's a big fan of Battlefield, and it kind of almost feels like there's a parallel there. He's sort of saying, you know, I've fucking played this game before, and them pretending to change the era, it does not mask the fact that this is the same gameplay that I've played in the last three Battlefields. And I mean, it looks pretty. I will say that for it. They've done a grand old job with the engine here. I think it looks really nice, especially that you can see how far they've up-resed all the texturing from the sort of the far distance stuff. And it's impressive, and I think it's quite fun, but I'm not sure it's quite what I was after.
Yeah, and I agree.
So JJ, he emailed us in this week as well about the same topic, and he says, "Hey buddies, I was ultra super pumped for Battlefield 1. We all know the shit show Battlefield 4's launch was, but it's running awesome now. Hardline launched well, and Battlefront went off without a hitch." That's true, I actually have forgotten that game launched fine, but it did.
It did indeed.
"How the fuck are the servers fucked? The netcode shit. EA knew how many were playing. They gave out the fucking codes. Yeah. I have to say, I'm pretty disappointed in the game itself, too. It looks like Battlefield, but plays more like Battlefront, part Hardline. Just give me a fucking reskinned Battlefield 4. There's always Verdun."
There is always Verdun, buddy.
So firstly, this isn't something that we were completely aware of, but I've been browsing around Twitter this evening, and it looks like this open beta is utterly fucked. No one can get into it. There's all sorts of problems, just massive queues waiting to get onto servers and stuff. And I've never really understood that when codes are sent out,
why does it not work?
I mean, it's a beta, but at the same time, this isn't our first fucking rodeo. We know what an open beta is these days. It's a demo to get you excited for a game and get you to pre-order that game. Yeah. They're not, yes, okay, they're testing server capacity to some degree, but at the same time,
they had a game out last year, or, they have games out now.
They know how games work.
Yeah, they know how a server fucking works.
And they know how excited people are for this game, and it looks like they've utterly fucked it. I think this is running fine for a few more days. I mean, it was fine yesterday. As you say, we did the insider thing. We got early access to the open beta, and everything was running fine. I'm hearing reports of a bit of a horror show this evening. But
that will happen.
At the same time, all the time it's under the guise of a beta, I suppose you can't level a great deal of criticism at it. It's when the game releases, and perhaps it's not within their best interests for an open beta to fuck up, because if they are using that as a demo for promotional purposes, then they don't really want to show a game that doesn't work. So
yep,
there is that as well. But on to his later comments, the fact that it just looks like Battlefield, plays like Battlefield. I think that's the big problem that people are going to have with this game, is that a lot of people are very excited because they wanted something fresh and exciting, and I don't believe that that's what it is. It does feel like DLC. It does feel like a skinned version of an older game, and I don't know, maybe I'm being harsh on it. I think it's going to go down brilliantly. I think it plays lovely. I think it's fun, man, and it plays really nice. I was enjoying it, but to a degree.
Yeah,
but it's got all those old Battlefield problems, and that's a bit of a shame. Just want something fresh, but perhaps that was too much to ask from the AAA games community, buddy.
Gibbons, buddy, I think you're right there. And, they know what they know the game that they make, and that game sells, so why change it drastically and disappoint so many people that love that kind of Battlefield prowess, I would say. But like JJ says, like at the end there, it plays more like part Battlefront, part Hardline. And he says he'd rather have like a reskinned Battlefield 4, and he's right there, because Battlefront and Hardline did feel completely different to Battlefield 4 in a way. I must say they're more arcadey.
Yeah, definitely.
Compared to like a bit more realistic in Battlefield 4. So yeah, I mean, even that's a valid point for me.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see how things pan out. I've no doubt this will sell incredibly well. We've got the Infinite Warfare reveals coming this next week or so as well, and that could put a spanner in the works and change things for everyone. But at this point, totally. Everyone seems a little underwhelmed by Battlefield 1. And
it's because Verdun's much better, buddy.
I don't think that that level was a great choice either. You know, setting out in the desert like that doesn't really make it feel very World War One. I think you want to
that's
the people's first
true.
Experience to be trenchy and you know, a bit French.
Well, I guess the one for the Alpha was a bit more like that.
Yeah,
wasn't it?
The footage we saw at E3, you know, made it look far. You know, this is Lawrence of Arabia shit we've got here, and that's fine. But it's not really the first thing people think of when they think of World War One. So,
not at all. Not for me, anyway.
So, well, we will keep an eye, and thank you very much for your comments and your feedback there.
Every week, we end the show with questions and comments sent in by you. If you've got anything for us, just pop an email to the jfgpodcast@gmail.com or contact us on Facebook, Twitter, or at justforgamers.co.uk.
And now it's time for JFG Street Beat.
You got a question, we want to know. Facebook, Twitter, we're on them all. So hit us up and be on the show. The JFG Street Beat.
Street Beat.
So once again, buddy, I reached out to our various communities with a question. If you aren't familiar with this, I did this last week, and I send a question out to a couple of gaming communities that I'm a member of on Facebook. I tweet it out, I Facebook it out on our own JFG community as well, and any responses I get back, I read out, and then we discuss them, and that's been working quite nicely for us. But firstly, as I did last week, buddy, I will ask you the question, and I think I already know the answer, but I would... You know, things are very changeable. So it's a funny question to ask a week before the PlayStation conference that's going to probably change the landscape a little. But I ask you, Ash, this very question.
Okay.
Do you think that the shortening of the console cycle is a good thing or a bad thing? And with that in mind, will you be splashing out on new hardware next year?
By shortening, do you mean like shorter than the ridiculous length of time that the Xbox 360 was alive for?
I mean that the next console shift is going to be one of the shortest ever. I mean, we've had the announcement of the new consoles within 3 years of the previously released ones, and it looks very likely that it's going to be a 4-year life cycle if the new consoles come out next Christmas.
I mean, like, we've had this discussion before. I think, what did I normally settle for? Like a 4 to 5 year gap, I think, I'm happy with between upgrading my consoles. I feel 3 is not long enough for the amount of investment that you put into these things. Especially, like, as soon as those new ones come out, like, the resale value of that, of your original console drops dramatically, which isn't good if you're going to sell it on. Also depends on like how much, you know, how, what an increase, you know, of graphics or whatever we're going to get. You know, I know that the difference between the 360 and the PS4 is, you know, impressive. You know, there's a lot of difference there. I just didn't feel like the jump between the original Xbox and the 360, you know, there wasn't that like standard def to high def jump. Whereas, you know, maybe in the next one with the 4K, if we have 4K TVs and shit, obviously, you know, maybe that'll be the next jump for me. Maybe because we're staying at the same resolution, I'm not that impressed by the current situation. I don't know.
Yeah,
maybe.
I think that'd help massively. Like, obviously... you know, jumping from HD to 4K is a massive thing, and that's the sort of thing that defines a new console cycle.
Exactly.
Doesn't it?
And I feel like that should have happened when the PS4s came out. You know, there should have been... I know that everyone wasn't ready, or hardly anyone's got, like, 4K TVs, or, well, unless you've bought a TV in the past couple of years, you probably haven't got a 4K TV kind of thing. So the infrastructure there isn't Well, it's not there, so it was pointless in making a 4K console or even feasible to do it 3 years ago. That's another point. And yeah, I'd say, yeah, 5 years I'm happy with. And I think shortening it is, it's not good for me, but I'm sure other people, because they're stupid, will buy it.
Well, I don't think it's stupid. I think if you've got the money to invest
in
that.
Yeah, that's true. If I had the money, I'd be like, yeah, fuck it. Just do it. I'll do it.
That's the thing, isn't it? I mean, you could comfortably say, and this was absolutely true of the last cycle, that the length of the cycle was stunting development. And that was angering PC gamers because the consoles were like a fucking gigantic titanium anchor, just like pulling everything back.
Yeah,
with the 360. Lovely. And yeah, these consoles launched underpowered. And yes, I welcome shorter cycles than, you know, 10 fucking gears or whatever. It was stupid. But at the same time, it does feel young in the cycle of this particular console. And this has been forced upon us. This is nothing to do with technology moving quicker. Like, a lot of people are saying that the landscape of the hardware has changed and that is why the cycle is shorter. The reason that the cycle is shorter is because the hardware developers skimped on the last cycle. That's the only reason. The reason that we're getting a Scorpio is because Microsoft didn't fork out the right amount of money on the previous console. The Xbox One was underpowered. They didn't take enough of a hit on it when they started selling it and invest safe in knowledge that they'd make a profit going forwards. And it's the same for the PlayStation.
Yeah,
powerful enough. 500 gig hard drive when you're trying to push an online service with games that are 60 to 70
Seriously.
Gigs in size. So it's not good enough, you know?
The problem that I'm thinking of, you know, like, obviously, at the time, if they did, you know, increase capacities here, there, and everywhere, what would the price been? Because, you know, we thought that the Xbox One came in with a Kinect, and we were like, fucking £450 or something, was it, I think, at launch? It's like, I'm not paying that, you know. If it had better hardware in it, then you're talking like £600-700. You're like, I'll just buy a fucking PC.
And obviously that there's a lot of balls in the air. They have to keep juggling the price against this, that, and the other. And yeah, absolutely. Like, in the short term, the price needed to be kept low. And
yep,
if that's what you're going to do, then fine. Quicker life cycle, that's fine as well. It very much depends for me. The second part of my question, buddy, next year, are you going to spend any money on hardware? And what will that hardware be if you do?
If it's worth buying, I would say. Firstly,
so next year,
I'd need to buy a new TV, though.
If it all comes down to the Neo, it does.
Yeah, I mean, we still know fucking nothing about this thing.
But if the Neo is what it leaked as in terms of the spec...
Yeah.
Will next year at Christmas, will you buy an Xbox Scorpio?
Probably not.
So what will you do next year? If the Neo's underpowered and the Scorpio's coming out as an alleged 4K system,
buy
where's your
GTX
cash going?
GTX 1080.
So you go PC.
I go back to my PC. It's what I always do. Like, when the console isn't powerful enough anymore, like with the 360, I was like, time to build a new PC. And you know, it's that's probably what's going to happen this time, because I mean, we've got a sweet deal with PlayStation at the moment with the game sharing and stuff like that. You know, we can't do that on Xbox. Exactly, for us right now, you know, saving money is, you know, the main thing. And yeah, okay, we're not going to have that 4K experience on a console, but, you know, maybe I could probably live with that for another year or so. I mean, especially if I upgrade my PC, then I'm gravy for another 2 years until I have to get, like, a new console or the next PlayStation or whatever, you know. But we'll just have to wait and see what these people come out with, you know. I think that's a part of the excitement, not knowing. They've already come out and said all these specs for the Scorpio, but that could all be bollocks, you know. You don't know. It's like, yeah, loads of teraflops. I'm like, great. Is it going to work, though? Is it going to have a menu system that like I can navigate
that
around
doesn't stutter,
yeah.
Has it got a menu system where I can talk to my buddy in a party while I'm scrolling through it? Because that'd be nice.
It would be nice, buddy. You know, all this horsepower, but, you know, simple things, buddy. Anyway.
So very, very briefly from me, I've said this before, but it comes down to what the Neo is. And if the Neo is a 4K gaming system as powerful or more powerful than the Scorpio, then I will buy that. If it isn't, then I will buy something to tide me over until a new PlayStation comes out. Backwards compatibility is the important thing for me in that regard. I don't want to buy the Scorpio if I can wait another year and get a PlayStation that lets me play all of the software that we've bought over the last three years.
Exactly, because so, that's a wealth of content on there now.
It is. It's loads of content. So I would be tempted to get either a VR headset or the Nintendo as
I mean, we didn't even mention the NX, and yeah, you're totally right. That could be like an interesting stopgap or something, you know.
That's my plan for next year. If the Neo is powerful enough, then I will buy it. If it isn't, if it pales in comparison to the Scorpio, then rather than getting the Scorpio, I'll wait for Sony to catch up and I will invest in the headset or the Nintendo, some sort of thing to tide me over until I can jump onto the next thing. So that's my plan. Although, you know, it's fluid, and this time next week, I need to look into when that Sony conference is, whether it'll hit or miss our podcast next week, buddy, because we'll have a lot to talk about if it's just happened when we go.
Yeah, that'd be nice if they could do that.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll phone them up. Send them a message.
So I've got a few responses from other people across our various communities as well. Firstly, from Tom. He says they could theoretically continue this idea of releasing a new PS4 or Xbox One every few years indefinitely now. But if they're only going to boast improved processors and RAM every time, you may as well just buy a PC and be done with it. The line between console and PC gaming is getting thinner all the time anyway, especially as couch co-op, one of the few remaining advantages of consoles, is going the way of the dodo. So I think he's kind of feeling the same way you do about the, you know, there's no point keep buying consoles to upgrade in the same manner that you would buy components for a PC. You might as well just get the fucking PC and enjoy improved graphics across the sort of 2 or 3 year cycles. So
it's going to become a modular based console, buddy.
It feels that way. And that's been kind of in the pipeline for some time.
Yeah, it has, isn't it?
Yeah. Could happen.
I mean, I'd be happy with that. Upgrade this, upgrade that. Bosh, plug it in. I mean, just look at like how easy it is to change out your hard drive on your PS4 now. You know, but then again, the 360 had like interchangeable hard drives, didn't it? Really?
Yeah, but you need that for memory and graphics and that sort of thing, don't you?
Yeah, that's totally. I mean, it's doable.
We've got to the stage now where the drivers aren't an issue. You could, in theory, you know, you could buy a graphics card for your console. If they wanted to go that way, they could package it in a console friendly fashion that you could just sort of
plug and play
in the back.
Yeah. Well, they do that one for the fucking laptops, don't they?
With the graphics card, and you can untether it and head off on your way.
Yeah, exactly. Bish bosh.
We got a comment from Richard. He says, I think it's all just a way to make people buy more iterations of the same console. I'm not into that. Seems like it will split the install base and make developing games harder, bad all round. I could not agree more about the install base thing, and I do not believe that developers are in a position where they can suddenly start creating games across split platforms. Like, people don't seem to have a problem with the idea that these games run on separate on you know, a PS4 and an upgraded PS4, and don't worry, it'll run on your old one. It's like, well, No, because it will run shit on your old one because these devs have not got time to optimize it for various different devices.
It won't be optimized. It'll be like the PC. It's like, here's some graphics settings. Set it up yourself until it runs all right or runs how you want it to run. Do you want more frames or do you want it to look better and run shit?
Yeah.
You
know? Ask yourself the question, if I was buying a title and on Steam and my computer just about met the minimum software requirements, would I be keen on buying that or not? You know, that's the question really.
All in.
And finally, we got JJ, who he made his feelings known several podcasts ago, but he says he thinks a 5-year life cycle is fine, provided there's full backwards compatibility. That's kind of how we all feel, I think. 5 years is gravy, and the way that the backwards compatibility stuff's going makes that more viable. If there was none of that backwards compatible stuff, then I think more people would be kicking off. But 5 years with backwards compatibility, fair play, I think.
Yeah, mate, totally. That is bang on the money for me, especially with that backwards compatibility. Like, everything that I bought for that previous console, I can play that still on the new one. It might even make it a little bit better, just like, you know, the Xbox One S or Xbones or whatever, you know. Yeah, I'm down with that. We can do it.
Gibbon.
Bang on.
Well, there we go. That's a good little discussion. Thanks so much to everyone who sent stuff in for us this week. Anyone who contributed, answered my questions, and so on and so forth. Thanks as well to Funk for his question too.
Gibbons.
So I think that'll about do us, buddy, for episode 75 of the podcast.
Oh, 75.
Ooh. Racking them up, buddy. Racking them up.
Yeah.
It's been a good one, I think. I've got this new setup. Hopefully I sound better this week than I did last week.
Compelling and rich, buddy. Heavy fact. On the bass. I mean, that's two.
Certainly some bass.
There. Yeah. Gibbons, I mean, today's podcast has gone swimmingly and there's been some beautiful transitions. Maybe I might even call it that. Who knows?
I'll be up for that.
We'll do that.
I've got no problem with that as a concept.
Mate, it's already been done.
Well, fair enough, I suppose.
There you go.
Can't argue with it.
No.
Well, there we go then. That's the JFG podcast, isn't it? Fair enough.
It's the truth.
Yeah, I suppose I'll do that old ending of the podcast thing that I do now.
I mean, if you want, I can cut it out of a previous one and just chuck it in.
Nah, mate, I'll do it. I'll do it quick because I want to get Sky Sports news on, mate. It's deadline day.
It is deadline day, you're right.
We'll get on that. Well, thank you very much for listening to our podcast. You can find us at www.justforgamers.co.uk. Ooh, you can find us at facebook.com/thejfgpodcast. Our Twitter handle is @thejfgpodcast. We're also on YouTube. You can find us there by searching the JFG podcast. We do our live streams on Mondays, and you can also catch the podcast on here thanks to Ash and his incredible skills. So there you go. We stream live this very thing that we are doing right now. We are live on YouTube on a Wednesday night from 8 p.m.
Indeed, we 8:30, are
something like that.
Yeah, whenever we fucking want, mate.
Damn right. Just deal with it. Yeah. SoundCloud.com/JustForGamers. You can find us on there as well. We are on various websites, including stuff like Stitcher. You can find us on iTunes, etc., etc. And we are also on Google+, if that is how you choose to live your life. Thank you so much for listening, buddies. And have a cracking week. And we will catch you next time. Until then, I have been Alex. He has been Ash.
Goodbye.
Take it easy, buddies. Goodbye.
You've been listening to the JFG podcast with Ash and me, Alex. To find out more, head to www.justforgamers.co.uk, Facebook.com/thejfgpodcast, or Twitter, where we are @thejfgpodcast. Episodes go live every Sunday, and if you could pop onto iTunes and write us a quick review, we would love every inch of you, even if you got old and fat. Thanks so much for listening, and we will catch you next time.